pleasure to have Stefano Lanza discussing strings at the end of this one plan. Go ahead.
Yes, first, good afternoon, everyone. And I would like to thank very deeply the organizers for having given me the opportunity to present my work here. So I will discuss about certain axionic strings that can be coupled to effective field theories. And while these strings can be very useful to try to explore the field space of the theory, and they can also be like signatures of quantum gravity within effective field theories. So my talk is is organized as follows. First, I will try to introduce you to the so-called swarm plane program that recently has been attracting more and more attention. Then I will try to review a conjecture within this program that is called the distance conjecture. And later I will present you a novel perspective for this conjecture, which is based on the axionic strings that I was mentioning before. So whatever I will say is based on this paper that we published 2 months ago. And it is made in collaboration with Fernando Marchesano from the IFT Madrid, Luca Martucci from University of Padova, and Irene Valenzuela from Harvard University. So to begin with, let us consider field theories that are built in the following fashion. First, we start from a quantum field theory. It can be, for instance, the standard model itself, or eventually some beyond standard model theory. And let us then assume to couple to this theory gravity, eventually just with the usual Einstein-Hilbert term. And let us assume that a theory so built is consistent. For instance, it is anomaly free, or there are no problems of unitarity and causality. And well, in general, the best that we can do is just considering this as an effective field theory that is valid up to a certain energy cutoff, lambda. Namely, beyond the scale lambda, we should expect that a more complete description should come in. And let us then consider the set of all the possible effective field theories that are built in this manner. The question that we wish to address is, can the effective field theories so built be embedded into a proper quantum theory of gravity? Or in other words, beyond the scale lambda, is there a quantum gravity theory that fully justifies this EFT below the scale lambda? Alternatively, one can also ask whether these EFTs originate from a proper string theory. And well, in general, we should expect that only a very tiny fraction of all the effective field theories comes from a full quantum gravity theory. And while these theories are said to belong to the landscape of consistent EFTs, all the others instead belong to the swarm plane, namely those theories which, albeit they look consistent from a purely effective field theory perspective, they do not admit a quantum gravity origin. And the whole point of the swarm plane program is trying to identify the boundaries between the landscape and the swarm plane. And typically this is done by formulating various criteria on the effective field theories. And these criteria go by the name of swarm plane conjectures. Well, during the last roughly 15 years, many of these conjectures have been proposed. For instance, you may be familiar with the no-global symmetry conjecture, which is actually far older than all the other ones. And this states that in all the theories that are consistent with quantum gravity, global symmetries should not be allowed. Or the weak gravity conjecture, that instead roughly says that in any effective field theories, the gravitational interaction should always be the weakest among all the interactions. Here, however, I will mostly focus on the distance conjecture, that is a constraint about the field space of the theory. And I will now very briefly review what this conjecture is about. So let us consider a generic d-dimensional effective field theory that is valid up to a certain energy cutoff lambda. And this theory is built with gravity and some other real scalar fields, phi I. These fields phi I span a certain manifold. And actually, since here we are assuming that there is no scalar potential, each point in this manifold actually represents a vacuum of the theory. And this GIJ that appears here in the kinetic terms for this field is just a metric over this field space. So with this metric, we can introduce the notion of a distance, and we can compute the distance in this way, exactly as we do in general relativity. And what is interesting here is that oftentimes in these manifolds, there are singular points. And towards these singular points, this metric diverges. And so eventually, there are points that are located at infinite field distances. And well, the swarm plane distance conjecture tells us that towards these points, well, something very bad is going to happen. In other words, in any consistent theory of quantum gravity, there exists an infinite tower of states that becomes exponentially light at any infinite field distance limit. So if we consider, for instance, a tower of state at a point P, let's say toward the bulk of this moduli space, and the same tower of states at a point Q, much closer to the singularity, well, the masses in Q are exponentially lighter than the masses in P. And so eventually, towards the singularity, the EFT is breaking down because, well, we are trying to include within our EFT an infinite number of massless degrees of freedom. Well, potentially the simplest example of realization of this conjecture is given by a 10-dimensional string theory that is compactified over a circle, an S1. So we end up with a 9-dimensional theory that contains a modulus, a radian. This radian parametrizes the size of this S1. So eventually one can try to enlarge this S1, sending the radian to infinity. This is an infinite field distance limit. And there exists a tower of states that becomes exponentially light. This tower of states is just the Kaluza-Klein tower. And let me stress to you also that here, this tower of states has a precise stringy origin. It comes from, well, Kaluza-Klein modes, which are stringy. And well, so now there are many arguments that support this conjecture. But however, all these arguments are based on top-down approaches. In other words, as in the example that I was showing you before, we start from a 10-dimensional string theory or eventually M theory or F theory, compactify down to lower dimensions. And then we investigate each infinite field distance limits and find that for each of these limits, there exists a tower of states that becomes massless. But however, here, I would like to take an opposite approach, a bottom-up approach. In other words, let us consider the point of view of an EFT theorist that generically does not even know that the EFT comes from a string theory. Can there be a mechanism directly in the EFT that drives the fields towards infinite field distances? Or can there be a mechanism that tells us that something wrong is going to happen at these infinite field distance limits? And well, our proposal is that the crucial objects that we should introduce in our theory in order to realize this distance conjecture are certain fundamental axionic strings. And I will specify what I mean with this weird wording. So first of all, I will now consider just four-dimensional effective field theories. And these strings are called here fundamental because they have strict dimension too. In other words, they span the single time direction plus another space direction. They are not thick string. We cannot resolve them within REFT. Moreover, these strings are electrically coupled to gauge two forms, exactly as particles are coupled to gauge one forms. And this EI is just the bare electrical charge of these strings. Furthermore, these strings are magnetically coupled to axions. These axions are, well, just the dual of these gauge two forms. And this coupling is such that once we encircle the string, these axions get shifted by the electrical charge of the strings. And moreover, these strings will be treated semi-classically. Namely, the tension of the strings is taken to be larger than the cutoff squared, and this will ensure us that we can neglect the oscillations associated to these strings. And well, whenever all these features are realized, we can couple these strings to an EFT just by adding the following action. This action is made up by two pieces. The first one is a Nambu-Goto term. It expresses the dynamics of the string. And here we have the string tension, which eventually depends on the fields of our theory. And then here we have the Chern-Simons term, which instead expresses the minimal electrical coupling of these strings. Now let me just take a very small detour to tell you what these strings can eventually be. And well, first, in string theory, it is extremely clear what these axion strings are. Namely, in string theory, well, there are many p-brains. These are p+1 dimensional objects. So whenever these objects are wrapped on certain p-1 internal cycles, in the macroscopic space, they look exactly as the axionic strings as I was showing you before. So here, well, the situation is pretty clear. But however, these axionic strings can also emerge in other fields of physics. For instance, they can naturally emerge in Goldstone models. Whenever we break a global symmetry, there can be in the theories like vortices solutions that in literature are oftentimes called global strings. And while in these cases, there is also a very nice interpretation for these axionic fields that appear. Namely, they are just the Goldstone particles for these models. And eventually, other axionic strings appear in the abelian or non-abelian in this model, and these are oftentimes called the Nielsen-Olesen strings. Or eventually, these strings can be astrophysical objects that were originated possibly during phase breaking happened during the inflation. And while in this context, they are oftentimes called cosmic strings. Here, however, I will mostly focus on the first interpretation, and we will actually need to embed these axionic strings in effective field theories that come from string theory. Specifically, we will need to embed the axionic strings in N=1 supergravity theories. So I will just remind you some very basic facts about these supergravity theories. So let us consider a supergravity theory that is made up by a certain set of chiral multiplets. So there are certain complex coordinates, this phi I, and I regard the real parts of this phi I as the axioms of the theory. While instead the imaginary part being, let's say, the supersymmetric partners of these axioms, I will call them saxions. Now, in the absence of a potential, all the theory is fully specified by the Keller potential. And I will assume that the Keller potential just depends on these saxions. This is true in many string theory setups. So we end up with a theory that is made up by gravity. And then there are the kinetic terms for the saxions and the axion. And the kinetic matrix is fully specified by the Keller potential. It is just its second derivative. Now, this is not properly the end of the story because here you see we have the axions, but we need to include the gauge two forms in order to couple strings. And in order to do so, we need a supersymmetric dualization that happens as follows. First, we need to dualize the axions to gauge two forms. This is, let's say, a conventional electromagnetic duality. But additionally, to preserve supersymmetry, we actually need also to dualize these axions to certain dual axions that are just the derivative of the Keller potential with respect to the original axions. And we then end up with a theory that depends on these dual forms, on these two forms via their field strengths. And here we can couple a string. We will also assume that these strings are BPS strings. They preserve half of the box supersymmetry. And in this case, while the string tension is fully specified by supersymmetry, and it depends on the charges linearly, and its tension is then specified by the derivatives of the Keller potential. Now, what we want to do is to study the back reaction of these strings onto the fields of the theory. So we just need to solve the equations of motion of this box supergravity coupled to this string. And the outcome is this one. So first, as I was anticipating you, when for well, the back reaction onto the axion, well, whenever we encircle a string, the axion is just shifted. But possibly more interestingly, let us look at the back reaction onto the saxions. Well, this depends logarithmically on this r, which is just the radial distance from the string. And well, what we want to do is to map this back reaction to trajectories in field space. In other words, we consider trajectories in the moduli space that are exactly of the same form as this back reaction. Now, interestingly, as we approach the core of the string, sending this r to zero, well, these axions go to infinity. And for a large class of Keller potential, these are, well, infinite field distance limits. And well, by the Swampland distance conjecture, we should expect that, well, something bad is going to happen. And in order to investigate this, let us explore what happens to the string tension. So the string tension, as we approach the core of the string, apparently goes to zero. It seems that the string, the string is becoming, well, lighter and lighter. However, this string is also a coupling of our effective field theory. And so we can borrow an interpretation that was put forward by Goldberger, Weiss, and later used by Polchinski. So as we can regard this back reaction onto the string tension as an RG flow of this coupling, the string tension itself. And the energy scale is just given by 1/1 the radial distance from the string. So this feature is here rephrased as follows. As we approach the string core, the string appears to be weaker and weaker coupled to the theory. And here, while something bad is going to happen, for this reason, if the string is becoming weaker and weaker coupled, while the oscillations that are induced by the strings, well, becomes lighter and lighter, and so they should be included within DFT. And actually there is a full tower of these oscillations. So in other words, our EFT is breaking down due to the appearance of these very light string oscillations. So to summarize what is going on here, as we approach the string core, or let's say better, as we move along the RG flow induced by the string tension, well, the fields are driven towards the boundary of the field space. They go to infinity. And this corresponds to infinite field distance limits. And also an infinite tower of states appear, the tower of string oscillations. So we are just realizing the distance conjecture that I was reviewing before. And this purely from an EFT point of view. So these observations have actually led us to propose a new conjecture that we call the distant axionic string conjecture. And it states that all infinite field distance limit of a 4D effective field theories can be realized as an RG flow endpoint of a fundamental axionic string. In other words—
hey, Stefano, you have a few minutes.
Yes, sure, I should be on time. So let us consider the moduli space of the theory for a finite cutoff. Then here we can just explore finite distances. If we want to explore distant regions located at infinite field distances, well, we need a string that triggers the RG flow that eventually then drive the field toward infinite field distance limits. Let me just point out that we, of course, verified this conjecture in a huge variety of string theory models. And in string EFTs, while we have a clear understanding of the towers that appear towards these infinite distance limits. And however, what is important is that, for instance, these towers can be Kaluza-Klein modes or winding modes, or they can eventually come from other deep brains. But however, what is important is that the falloff of all these tower of states is always dictated by the string tension. And specifically, these tower of states become massless with an integral power of the string tension. So to conclude, well, I've tried to convey you that the axionic strings can be helpful tools in order to explore the field space of the theories, and specifically, they trigger an RG flow that would eventually drive the fields towards infinite field distances. In other words, these strings can be useful to explore distant regions within the moduli space. And towards these regions, while these strings become tensionless, and this is also signaled by the appearance of an infinite tower of states associated to the string oscillations. So we verified our conjectures in N equal one supergravity theories, but it would also be very interesting to test these conjectures also in other non-supersymmetric cases. It would also be very interesting to try to relate our conjectures with all the other swamp plane conjectures, as well as it would be very nice to try to see this picture from a more phenomenological point of view, possibly relating our axionic strings like with Nielsen-Olesen strings or cosmic strings. So thank you very much for listening.
Thanks, Stefano. So are there any questions? Fabio. I don't know whether Andrea or Fabio, which one were first. Let's start with Fabio.
Okay, I have a question on your introductory part. There is a point I didn't understand very well. Probably around page 9, when you presented the simplest example illustrating the distance conjecture, you took what you called the 10-dimensional string theory compactified over a circle.
Yes.
And then you said that for large value of the radian, you get an infinite tower of Kaluza-Klein modes, stressing that that's a stringy effect. I don't see where this is stringy. Wouldn't you get the same result if you take a 10-dimensional theory of gravity and compactify it on a circle?
It was exactly my question I was about to ask too.
I say that this is a stringy tower because, well, I would imagine these Kaluza-Klein modes as emerging from, a proper 10-dimensional string theory. But yes, I may agree that eventually also reducing other 10-dimensional theories, this can emerge.
Just take Einstein gravity in 10 dimensions. Wouldn't you get the same Lagrangian in 9 dimensions if you compactify it on a circle?
Yes, I would say that here the point is that we start from a 10-dimensional theory that is for sure consistent with quantum gravity. I mean,
but let me clarify that, Stefano. I mean, what happened is that in the original distance conjecture, what makes it stringy is the occurrence at the same time of the Kaluza-Klein and the winding modes. It's that actually makes it stringy, not the Kaluza-Klein per se, right? In the origin, one of the of the Swampland reviews, one by Palti, indeed stressed, as Fabio was saying, you need also the.
I agree with that. Eventually, there is also the winding modes.
Without the winding modes, this is not true, as Fabio was saying.
No, but no, I don't think I'm saying the same thing. I accept the point that 10-dimensional theory of gravity is not consistent. So to make your statement, you need an underlying presumably consistent string theory. On the other hand, this particular effect, my point was just that this particular effect is not intrinsically stringy. Okay. But I think we clarified the point.
Okay, sure. But I mean,
do you have more questions, Fabio? Or?
No, thanks. I go with my hand.
Andrea.
I'm a bit confused because I don't see. So, this, I have a general question on this swampland, picture. I mean, what does this bring us more than ordinary string theory pictures? I mean, the string theory in the ultraviolet is known, and so what is the new ingredient?
Are you, let's say, questioning the distance conjecture itself?
I mean, I don't understand. Is this a rephrasing of the ordinary string theory approach with compactification and this is what you have special here, the fact that you have a singularity or
yes, but imagine to start not exactly from string theory but from a lower dimensional effective field theory and you find infinite field distance limits. There you generically don't even know that you're working with an effective field theory that comes from string theory. So I would say
you cannot cannot go backward with the optimization group. So if you assume that you start from an effective theory, there is no way to predict what will be the UV completion. So it's impossible. So unless you assume a ultraviolet theory, you won't get anywhere. So I don't get it this point.
I would say that this is the whole point of the Swampland program. We are trying to identify criteria directly within effective field theories in order to say that an effective field theory is consistent, like with string theory.
Well, to me, it's impossible. Anyhow, a naive answer is impossible. But okay.
But this is the whole point of the program.
Okay.
I mean,
are there other questions? Otherwise, I have a specific question on Stefano's work. I cannot see any other. Please tell me if I'm missing anyone. So just to go back to your work, Stefano.
Yes.
One thing that I'm a little bit, I would like you to explain it better, right? So I definitely see that you are exploring the distance conjecture within an effective description, effectively, you know, as these killer terms constructed. The question that I cannot see right now is that while this is an effective description and the strings emerge as, you know, basically extended objects in your theory, right? Because I mean they're basically extended object in your theory.
Yes, right? I don't think that I got exactly your point. You mean why
are these just extended objects?
Yes, indeed, they are extended objects. Yes, exactly. Right. Yes.
So how would this model know about the underlying theory of quantum gravity?
Well, I'd say from here.
What's the information
that there are two main points here. The first one is that in EFTs obtained from quantum gravity, we typically have singularities. So how can you detect these singularities? Well, we propose that we need these axionic strings, let's say at the tip of these singularities. And secondly, a tower of states emerge there. And well, the fall off of the masses of these tower of states are related to the fall off of the string tension.
But wouldn't you also have the winding modes, which that's what I would think are actually a lamppost for having, for example, string theory.
Yes, eventually.
But you're not looking at this winding modes.
Yes. We are looking also
at winding
modes. Yes,
okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
I mean, these tower of states can be closed Klein modes or winding modes, which can eventually fall off with the same paper or with a different.
All right. All right.
I can also tell you something more eventually.
No. But I think in the economy of the you answer my question. So thank you. In the economy of time,
Yes, thank you very, very much for all the questions. Okay.